In this video, we will start the process of attacking our player. So the first thing we have to do is to create all our animations. So if we go to the enemy and animation, we will see we have a die down and idle in all directions and walk in all directions. But we haven't created our attack in all directions. So what we have to do is to go to the sprites folder and find our skeleton. And as you can see, we need to create all the attacks. So select all the attack down. Set the pixel per unit to 300 and click apply, and then simply drag it into the scene and write attack underscore down. Just going to add it to this folder, then I'm going to take attack, the new one I created, into the enemy one animation and delete the controller. Then I'm going to take and do the exact same thing for attack left, apply, drag it in, and then call it attack underscore lift, and drag this one into the enemy one folder, delete the component there, attack right, select all of them, 300, apply, drag them in, attack underscore right, and drag it into the enemy one folder, delete the controller, and then we need to do it for the same thing for the up, 300, apply, and drag it into the scene, and attack up underscore up. Delete the controller and take attack up and move it into enemy one folder, and then delete all the new attacks from the scene. When you've done that, just save your project and save your scene. Then select the enemy, go to the animator and find the attack layer, and then select the attacks. Select the blend tree and go to the enemy one folder. Make sure that you replace all these with the correct ones from the enemy. So take attack down, put it down, attack left, put on left, attack right and put it on right, and attack up and put it on up. If you forget to replace this, then the skeleton is going to turn into a wizard when he starts attacking. So it might be a fun effect, but that's not what we want. We would like it to keep or stay as a skeleton when he attacks the player. So that's why we need to replace these animations. So if we don't do it, we will use the player's animations for tagging, and that's going to look very odd. So now with that done, I would like to address one thing. You might get an exception when we click here. As you can see, there's null reference exception right there. And that's because we are actually clicking on the enemy's range. As you can see here, there's a circle around him. And by mistake, when we want to select him, we are clicking on this. So to make sure we can't click on this by mistake, we can select the range over here and then go to the layers and make sure that the range isn't clickable. It's only the enemy that needs to be clickable so that we can click on him with our mouse. As you can see here, if we play it now, we can select our enemy and deselect him again, and we should be able to attack him with the player like so, as you can see here. So right now the enemy is immortal, he can't die, and that's because we have replaced the animator with another one. So we need to set that thing up again, but that's not going to take a long time when we get to that. So what else? There's one thing we need to do. If we go to the scripts and open our character script, then we will have to go to the character, go all the way down, and we need to find something called stop attack. Let's see here, stop attack here. Stop attack is only used for the player because the player needs to interrupt his attacks mid casting if the user of the game is going to click a button. But the enemy shouldn't be able to interrupt their attacks. They should finish their attack before they are done with them, right? They can't interrupt it mid fight. At least not for now. So this stop attack here is only meant for the player. So you can select stop attack and cut it out, like so, and then go to our player and go all the way to the bottom, and right here we have something called stop attack. Just paste the other one underneath it and take spellbook.stopattack, cut that line and paste it down here, delete the original one in the player and make it non-virtual, like so, because we're not going to use it in the enemy, so there's no reason to have it all the way up in the player. Another thing, if we go to the player now, or the character, you'll see stop attack is trying to be called inside handle layers. Well, we don't want that. We don't want stop attack to be called up here. So delete stop attack. And now you'll notice if we play the game now, we are not able to interrupt our attacks. So I can attack the player. And now I can move around and still attacking. And I don't want that. So we need to go to our player and find handle input or something. Let's see here. Get input. Down here, we need to say if. And we need to check something. And what do we need to check? Well, we need to check if we are attacking or not. Or moving, I mean. So here we say is moving. So if we are moving, we call stop attack. Oh my, stop attack, there we go. So save this and jump back. And now you should be able to interrupt your spells by moving, as you could before. So what we did haven't changed anything. It just moved the code around to make it more correct. What should I say? There we go. So the last thing I would like to do is to create the new state. So let's go to our enemy states, right click in the folder, create new C# script and call it attack state. So we need to open up that new script. And let's see, as you can see here, there's actually an error. Attack state, it doesn't, mono behavior doesn't turn green. So this means that this can't interact with the other scripts here by mistake. So if you ever get that error, the best thing is to close down Visual Studio and try to open up again. And see if it helps. So yes, let's see here, attack state. And if mono behavior is still not lighting up, then basically what I usually do is to go out and delete that new script that has the error that doesn't work. And then I just create it again. So at least that's what I found working. This is not happening a lot, sometimes it just happens. So you have to do that. So let's see, and now mono behavior turns green. So attack state is a form of state, so I write colon I state to implement the interface. I delete all the code, right click quick actions and implement interface, and then I delete the non-implemented exceptions here, like so. So we can try to set up the basics of the state in this video. So let's see, we need an enemy, private parent, enemy parent. And we need to set this right here, so this dot parent equals parent. Now it's set. And we will also need to figure out if we need to attack or not, but I think I'll leave that out for the next video. So what do we need to do? Well, if our parent dot target isn't null, so if our parent's target is null, then we need to check range and attack. So right now we're not going to do anything. So let's just leave it like this so it doesn't do anything, so we can check if it goes in here and just stays there doing nothing. Let's see, we have our follow state, and it's from the follow state we need to go into the attack state somewhere. So inside our update here, we need to calculate a distance between the enemy and the target. And we can do that by saying float distance equals vector 2 the distance between our parent dot target dot position and our parent dot transform that position. So the distance between our target and the parent is measured here. If that distance is less or equal to our attack range. So we need to add an attack range. So inside the enemy, where is it? It's over here, somewhere there. We can make a new property called as a float. We can call it my attack range. So the attack range needs to be set somehow. And I don't know what we should set to. We need to experiment a little with that. But in a way, we can say attack range. Oh, not that one. It's my attack range equals 2 or something. So let's see if 2 is okay. So that's 2 units. So if the distance is less or equal to the parent's dot attack range. Well, then we need to attack. So we can say parent dot change state, new attack state. So if we are close enough to attack, that's what we're looking at right here. If we are close enough to attack, then we change into the attack state. Okay, let's see here. And then we can go to the attack state and do nothing right now. So let's see if we play it now, what actually happens. The player walks in here, enemy walks towards him. And I guess he's close enough to attack right there, because he stops doing anything right there. And now he's stuck. He's not going to do anything. He's not going to follow us or anything, as you can see. So now we need to know, we need to go back in a follow state, for example. So let's see here. If we go down here, I think 2 is also very big distance. Let's try to go to the enemy and say the range is 1, maybe. Just want to see how close that it is before he attacks. Yeah, that fits better, right? For a melee attack. So I'm going to keep the ranged 1 right now. Then we need to go to the attack state. Right there. And inside the attack state, we will have to check if we need to go back to a idle state or something, right? So if our target isn't null. Well, else, we need to say our, yeah, I just want to see what, yeah, what do you want to do? Down here, I want to say parent.change state to a new idle state. So this means if the enemy loses the target while we are in the attack state, he'll just idle. So if he's attacking the player and the player just flees away or something, well, then we just change state back to idle. What else? We need to follow him also. So we need to say, we need to calculate the distance again. So float distance equals vector 2. Actually, can we just go here and take distance line here? Copy that from follow state. Go back to attack state and paste it there. No reason to write the same code more times. So if our distance is larger equal to the parent.attack range. So if the distance is larger, then we say parent.change state, new follow state. So if the player gets out of range, then he starts following again. And remember, we're not attacking yet. We are going to add that in the next video. So we save this, and let's see here. So now the enemy should be able to walk towards the player. And stop. So now he's basically attacking the player, and the player walks out of range and he starts following the player again, and then he starts attacking and walks out of range. So basically, if you want to see if this works, you can go to update and write debug.log attacking inside attack state, and you can go to follow state and go to update in the top here and write follow, and you can go to the idle state and write idle in the update right there. So if you want to see how it actually looks, so just right click using Unity. Ah, that was what I wanted to do. Using Unity Engine. There. So if we save this and jump back in here and open up our console, should be able to see he's idling right now, the enemy. And it, I think it didn't save that. Let's try save and follow state. I think I'm using the wrong, it is actually there. Let's try to save and run one more time. It might not, it might have been an error. Let's try again. So idle, follow, attacking, keeps attacking me. Start moving, he starts following me. If I move out of range, I stop here, he attacks me. Keep moving. If I move out of range, he should start idling if I get that far away from him. It's actually pretty hard to outrun him though. There we go. Now he idles and then he starts following again and attacks me. Okay, so now you can see all the states are actually working right there. So that's what I want to do in this video. In the next video, we are going to add the actual attack functionality, or make the enemy throw an attack at me when I get close to him. So thank you very much for watching. Thanks for watching my video. Please remember that InScope Studios is a community found page, so please consider clicking the support link on the screen to see how you can support me and get something back in return.